Bloomberg New Economy. This is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Catherine Glass with Bloomberg New Economy. How do you hear me?
Hello, Catherine. I have you loud and clear.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for joining us, Megan. You're almost 2 months into your six-month mission at the International Space Station. How's it going? And what's it like up there?
Well, Catherine, it's going really, really well. Our team had a very successful spacewalk yesterday, so everybody's still kind of enjoying that success, actually looking forward to the next big spacewalk, which is coming up on Friday. And every day brings a new set of challenges, but it's a lot of fun every day, and we're really enjoying it.
What are some of the most important applications of the research that you're doing at the International Space Station and the technology, the space technology that you're using? What are some of the most important applications for that stuff on Earth?
That's a great question. We are doing lots of different kinds of research aboard the International Space Station. We do medical research, we do technology demonstrations, and in both cases, they do have applications not just for space flight and for space exploration, but also for returns for Earth. So one of the technology demonstrators that we have on board space station right now is water reclamation. So we right now are reclaiming 93% of the water on the board the International Space Station, and we have a new technology demonstrator that's hoping to bring that number up to 98%, which is going to be really important for us for long-duration space missions. But as you can imagine, the ability to have access to clean water, of course, is also very important on Earth. And so in some harsh and remote environments where people don't have ready access to clean water, the space station technology has been adapted so that technology can be used, the purification and filtration can be used to provide clean water, which is life-saving in some settings on Earth.
Wow, that's really interesting. You know, before you were an astronaut, or prior to being an astronaut, you were also an oceanographer. So speaking of water, what are some of the learnings, you know, the connections between the learnings that you've had in space? How does that compare to what you've learned on missions in the ocean?
I have always thought that there are similarities between ocean exploration and space exploration. Sometimes I get people that are confused and say, well, you were an oceanographer, how did you end up as an astronaut? But really, if you think about it, when you go out on a ship and you're doing research at sea, you have to be able to use what you have on board to complete your mission. So if something breaks, there's somebody on that ship that has to know how to fix it. You need all of the equipment you're going to need for the duration of your mission to be with you, because you're not just going into port every night. And so there's a lot of similarities with the way we operate in space. Of course, we have a really extensive, really smart ground team that we can rely on to provide that extra level of support that we didn't have as much in oceanography. But we also, you know, when something breaks up here, we need to be able to fix it. We need to have a variety, all the varieties of equipment that we might need. And then you need to get creative to solve problems that you hadn't thought of before you left on your mission.
What will define success for you on this mission, and what more do you hope to learn in your next few months while at the International Space Station?
So one of the really unique things, I think, about being a part of a mission like this, our expedition is going to be host to something like 200 different scientific investigations, and we have varying levels of interaction with those investigations. Some were very involved, where we're doing something every day, and we're hours, for example, in a glove box, where we're pipetting different cells and different treatments to work on an immunity study, and other things we have very simple interactions with, where we're exchanging cartridges out of an experiment that largely runs on its own, for example. But over 200 science investigations, you can imagine the results from those are going to be coming out over many years to come. And so getting to participate in so many of those experiments and then for the next several years getting to hear about the discoveries and the successes, I think, is really exciting. And so for me, success is going to be just kind of meeting the challenge every day of doing whatever those small tasks are that enable those discoveries in the long term. That's what I think success will look like for me.
Do you feel like you've had any breakthroughs so far on some of those research experiments that you've been doing?
Well, like I said, you know, so 2 months, it might sound like a really long time, but in terms of scientific discovery, sometimes, you know, the discoveries take a little bit longer. One thing I think that's really interesting that we have going on right now, that's a spaceborne computer, too, that's been recently activated aboard the International Space Station. And the idea with that is to bring edge computing to the International Space Station. So right now, with all of the research projects that we have going on, we send a ton of data to the ground. And then once it reaches the ground, ground, then the scientists have access to it. They can analyze it. They can get the information that they're looking for and, you know, work on their research studies. But if we bring that more computing power here to the International Space Station, that processing can happen here, and then they get their information rather than just raw data, and that time to insight goes from months to maybe minutes. And so that, I think, is very exciting. That's going on right now, and that's really going to help power our future missions, where when we have, you know, an outpost on the moon, we're going to be generating a ton of data, and that's really going to help us turn it around by bringing these modern computing technologies to the International Space Station and to our future exploration missions.
Wow. Back here on Earth, space tourism is kind of all the rage, with billionaires like Jeff Bezos saying he's going to go into space. What do you think about that? I mean, you're a seasoned astronaut, you know what to expect, but do you think it's a good idea to make space travel, you know, more available to regular people?
So I'm always saying, you know, when I'm talking to my family or with my friends, you know, I wish you could see this. It's so beautiful. Or I wish you could experience this. And that really is true. I think over the long term, I really think that it would be amazing for more people to get to experience what we get to experience up here in space. But of course, there are risks. You have to accept those risks if you're going to do something like fly in space. And I think especially right now and in the foreseeable future, you have to have a certain amount of grit to deal with the challenges that exist, you know, the practicalities of living in space, and to really get the joy out of it. You have to be willing to endure a little bit, I think.
Speaking of conversations you have with your family, I know you have a son. Do you believe, or do you guys have conversations about whether or not there is intelligent life on other planets?
You know, he has not posed those kinds of questions exactly. He is still, you know, kind of at that cusp of are the cartoons that he sees real, you know, or the stories that he sees real. And so he's just starting to sort through all of that. I absolutely would tell him I think that there is life elsewhere in the universe. The universe is so mind-bogglingly vast that to me it's hard to believe that there isn't life somewhere else in the universe. And, we have the James Webb telescope launching soon, and one of the things that it will be able to do is potentially detect atmospheres that are similar to our own, which could be a beacon for us of life somewhere else in the universe. So that's very exciting. We also are thinking about missions to Europa, one of Jupiter's moons that has oceans. And oceans are, of course, a source of very unique life on Earth in extreme environments. And so that may also be a place for us to find signs of life. So lots of exciting things coming in the future, and I think lots of reasons to believe that there certainly is life somewhere in this vast, vast universe that we're a part of.
What's the most surprising thing you've discovered about yourself while on this mission? What's the biggest challenge that you face while you're in space?
So those are a couple of different questions. I don't know that I have surprised myself about myself necessarily. The challenges that we face are, you know, we have practical challenges, which are, you know, so yesterday, for example, my crewmates moving around a 750-pound solar array. How do you do that safely without losing control of it? That's kind of a big practical challenge. And a smaller one is, you know, how do you eat your dinner before it floats away from you? So a smaller practical challenges. And we have lots of those little challenges all of the time. And you meet those challenges with different coping mechanisms. You're mindful about your movements. You're mindful about your environment. We have, of course, the challenge of living in an isolated environment. We rely on each other as a crew. We use humor a lot to face the different challenges and frustrations that we have. So there's a lot of ways that we work together to meet those different challenges.
Last question for you, Megan. You're orbiting 260 miles above Earth's surface. Does being that high up, does it change your perspective on Earth?
We are so fortunate to live on this beautiful planet that we have, and I have always known that, you know, living on Earth, going to our beautiful national parks and visiting beautiful places around the world, but seeing the Earth from space, it is so beautiful, this blue marble that we have, but you also can see the fragility of it. You see how thin the atmosphere is relative to this vast blackness of space, and you feel, I think, very protective about the Earth and a very strong desire to protect it, because it's what is protecting us. It is our spaceship through the universe, and so it's definitely a responsibility that we have to protect our beautiful planet.